from Chicago's CAN TV. This is Chicago Newsroom.
Well, hi there, and welcome to Chicago Newsroom here on CAN TV. I'm Ken Davis. You know, the University of Illinois Chicago's Barbara Ransby quoted the following in The Nation a couple of days ago about Lori Lightfoot's win. It was from Aislinn Pulley, the lead organizer of Black Lives Matter Chicago, saying, "We should view this election cycle as the beginning of a seismic shift against the neoliberal project that has resulted in privatization, militarized policing, and destruction of many of our community institutions and resources." Is she onto something? It's just possible that we've had it up to here with this idea that if the schools aren't being cleaned to your satisfaction, the solution is to let a contract for hundreds of millions of dollars to a politically connected company that'll hire minimum wage workers to replace the people earning a decent living and benefits. What we so often see is that the job isn't done anymore effectively. A bunch of people got fired or got their pay cut by a third. It doesn't cost the taxpayers any less, but a few well-positioned companies make a bunch of money. Well, that's just one of the things we're going to be talking about on the show today as we try to figure out Mayor Lightfoot's strategy for saving Chicago. You know, that's her job. She's got to save us. And I have the temerity to have some free advice to offer her, too, here on the program. So here's our panel of advisors. Delmarie Cobb, Publicity Works, political advisor to the greats, and still working at that, even in this election right now. So we'll be talking about that. Delmarie, welcome back. Dr. Bruce DuMont, the Dean of Chicago Political Analysts in Chicago. Always a pleasure to have you here.
But not really a doctor. But not really
a doctor. Not a real doctor, yeah. Beyond the Beltway, of course, just a great guy to have around at a time like this. And A.D. Quig, I can't say enough great things about the Daily Line and what you guys have been doing lately. You're just doing some really great work. And I just hope at some point you get like 8 hours off and you can take a nap, because it would be really
good. I would like that too.
Yeah, it would be great.
Tell me
it?
About it.
Been a lot of sleepless nights around here lately. So let's begin with this. There's a great photograph in the Chicago Sun-Times cover today of Lori Lightfoot walking into the office for the first time. She's meeting Mayor Emanuel. And by the way, Mayor Emanuel was just standing right around the corner waiting for the camera to cue him to walk out. But that's a different story. What did they talk about? Go.
It was a 50-minute meeting, mm-hmm. and they talked about all the reasons why they love the city of Chicago. And Mayor Rahm Emanuel said he was going to prepare her about a 250-page transition report because he wants it to be as smooth
and
as possible.
And she'll read the 4-page summary.
Yeah. We'll get to see the 4-page summary. But she has, you know, now 46 days before she takes office, and it's a full sprint.
She's a lawyer. She'll read all 300 pages.
Yeah. I think it, as they've described it, I think it probably was very, very cordial. I mean, he's a politician, but he's also going out. He wants a good relationship with her, even though they've had a couple of rough patches. And I would say that between the two options to replace him, Lori was probably the one he was cheering for.
You think so?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, well, there's just this kind of fantasy that I have of the two of them sitting down, because if I'm not mistaken, the last time they met, wasn't it that really awful time when she wanted to be reappointed to the police board and they had this like very tense meeting?
Yes.
That was the last time that we know of.
Yeah. But yes, she was seeking to be president of the police board once again, mm-hmm. and she had come out very publicly against the way he had approached police reforms in that time, mm-hmm. saying he wasn't being aggressive enough in the consent decree, wasn't being aggressive enough on the FOP contract. The city should be expressing its values on what it wants on reform. So yeah. They went in tense, and she came out with the appointment, and I think it was 10 months later she was running for mayor of Chicago.
Yeah. Let's not forget about Toni Preckwinkle. Let's talk about her for a few moments, because we don't want history to just move on too quickly here. Delmarie, you've known and worked with Toni Preckwinkle for years. How's she handling this? How's this going to work for her? Is she going to be okay with this?
Well, first of all, this is not her first loss. Yeah. She lost the first two times she ran for office, when she ran for alderman in the 4th ward.
So this is a little different.
Well, it's a little different, but yeah. It's, I mean, but you can only feel so badly when you're still the Cook County Board President. And so it's not like she didn't secure that first. Yeah. And so, I mean, she missed her window of opportunity because her window of opportunity was in 2008 and 2012 probably. So she missed her window of opportunity. I mean, 2011, I should say, in 2015. Yeah. So she missed her opportunity, but she still is has made history. First of all, she went from an alderman to another body of government altogether. So not the one she served in, but a completely different one. She became the president of the Cook County Board, and then she became the chair of the Democratic Party. There's no other person who's done that. There's no other woman or black person to do that. So even though we have something new that's historic, we cannot put her, kick her to the curb and say, well, your old history, your history doesn't matter. Only the new history matters. Yeah. I mean, she still is going to go down in history.
But the reality is her history and her profile were overwhelmingly rejected by the voters. I think a lot of voters were resentful that someone that just got elected to county board president, you know, 3 weeks later decides she's going to run for mayor. You know, what was that all about? Yeah. She ran unopposed. I mean, Tony Preckwinkle has never really had a tough race other than when she was running against Tim Evans, and Tim Evans beat her all the time. So this was a real race. She was on a platform with a lot of media spotlight, and I think she ran a horrible campaign, and her inability to denounce the rhetoric of Bobby Rush, to me, I think it turned me off. I think it turned a lot of voters off. She showed a lack of courage in standing up to Bobby Rush. She showed a lahk of courage of not running against Rahm Emanuel when she probably could have beat him 4 years ago. So,
well,
that's my assessment.
The timing, as I said, was bad because, of course, it was Ed Burke. I mean, you cannot minimize Ed Burke, and I don't think the Bobby Rush thing had that much to do with it because it was towards the end of the campaign. It wasn't at the beginning of the campaign, so it did not set the tone. I mean, Bobby Rush was for Bill Daley in the beginning.
Yes.
So the whole thing was, it was about Ed Burke, and she got caught up in that. And anybody who knows her knows that when she was in city council, there was no relationship with her and Ed Burke. But it was the timing, it was the sea change, and it became the narrative. And she didn't run a very good campaign. She ran a horrible campaign. And Lori Lightfoot ran a brilliant campaign. So you cannot deny the contrast between the two campaigns. And she did not know how to pivot. And that was where she failed, because she didn't understand the message that she should have been talking about. And given where she came from, her message should have been that I was an alderman for 20 years. When I took over the fourth ward, there were 2,000 vacant lots. When I left, there were 200. I know how to rebuild a ward, and I know how to rebuild a city. Mm-hmm. That was the message. She never said that message.
She did say it. I just don't think anyone heard it.
Well, she didn't say it the right way.
Yeah. It wasn't evident in the ads.
Right.
It also wasn't relevant to voters today, you know, what she did as alderman.
No, but it was relevant to black people. Rebuilding a ward and rebuilding a city was the most important issue black people wanted to hear. And if she had come out with that message, she would have had black people from the very beginning. That's all we want to hear. When you go through our communities and see that they're gutted and they're being depopulated while we're watching the north side being repopulated, that is all we want to hear.
Although, you know, we had Joanza Malone on show last week from COCO, and he wasn't that charitable about it. He said, yeah, she built, you know, 1,500 units of affordable housing, but she chased 20,000 people out of the ward when they tore all the public, you know, the high-rises down.
Well, she didn't chase them out. I mean, that was the city, mayor.
You know, I mean,
yes.
It happened in her ward.
Right, and she fought to bring them back.
Yeah. The other thing that was happening is during that same period, there was another player who I think was one of the big winners the other night, and that's Dr. Willie Wilson. Mm-hmm. Look what he did in the primary. He endorsed Lori Lightfoot, you know, rather quickly after that. And again, he's the one that has literally deep pockets and very positive reaction in the African American community. And he's been doing that not only in the last 3 years, but the last, you know, 7 or 8 years, where he's been providing money to people that are down and out, bail money for people in county jail. So he's sort of usurped the old alderman or the old committeeman in doing favors for people.
Well, this time he knew he had to make a decision quickly because he
didn't
do it in 2015.
Right.
And that's when Chewy needed him to do it, and he hemmed and hawed, and he waited until the last minute. Yeah. And at that point, it didn't make a difference. He got the same 50,000 votes this time that he got the first time.
Yes, that's right.
And
right.
But the difference was that when he came out for Lori, mm-hmm. and gave his nod, that for people who, because she came in third in most of those wards. Tony came in second, mm-hmm. but once he said, "I'm with her," then they turned. Yeah. They went with him.
That is such an important point to make, is that he didn't really do any better this time than he did last time, but he learned how to use the power
exactly.
that he accumulated. I was
and
at
radio that, spots
and radio spots too. Absolutely. I mean, I was at that that event when he sort of handed over the baton to her down at the I forget where, but
Baptist
Institute, and. I was just amazed by it. It was the electricity in that room and the power that you felt in the room was really much more than I had thought it would be, and I think it had an effect.
Interesting how many coalitions she's managed to build through these endorsements as she's gone.
Right.
She got Willie Wilson, but she also got Matt O'Shea. She also got the firefighters on the Northwest side, and we saw this in the results on Tuesday night. She won every single ward, almost every precinct except for a few in Hyde Park.
So why did the firefighters of the Northwest side go with her? What caused that? I mean, I'm still scratching my head over that one. It doesn't fit the pattern that we've assumed.
I don't think they would have chosen her in the first round, but in the second round they said, and I've heard this from folks who have been in endorsement sessions with her in tons of different rooms, that they love that she's a straight shooter. Mm-hmm. She comes in understanding what they need and want.
Yeah.
So firefighters were like, "We need new rigs." She understood that we needed new rigs. And she understands that we need a contract quickly. Mm-hmm. And we like that she's a straight shooter, and Anthony Napolitano described her as a firecracker and just said everyone in the room was blown away just by how straightforward and to the point she was.
She, in addition to being a straight shooter, she is very smart.
Mm-hmm.
She may be the best combination of those two.
Yeah.
Of any mayor we've had in recent decades.
Well, Rich Daley actually put her into two of the biggest crucibles that he had, because he put her into the procurement thing. But I was around for the opening of the 911 center, and it was, I think it's fair to say that, how do I want to put this? A part of the reason why that thing got built in the first place was because it was so impossible to settle the 100-year-old battle between the police and fire department, right? They had their own, they each had their own dispatch, they had their own helicopter, their own boats, their own everything. And I think Daley recognized that it was time for there to be a common dispatch and for there to be a sort of an emergency response that covers all of the emergency responders. And my sense of it, and this is not from anything that I actually know, it's just a sense, it really wasn't working out all that well. And I think that's part of what Lori Lightfoot was brought in to try to...
She was a fixer.
...see if she could fix some of this.
So
it doesn't surprise me that firefighters say, "Yeah, you know, you gave us a fair shake when you were at OEMC. I don't know. It's just an impression that I have,
but at least that meant they knew her, so at least they had some familiarity with her.
Right.
She starts with a lot of people liking her.
Right. This is the honeymoon.
She's got 46 days, and then on that 47th day, a few people are going to be spinning off.
Yeah.
Well, the tough decisions come immediately. They're coming right into office as the summer begins, when we typically think of Chicago crime, hiking. She's got to come up with her first budget, which generally gets introduced in September, debated through October, decided by November.
Yeah.
They need to come up with a $270 million pension payment.
The
tough decisions come quickly, and the honeymoon, I think, will be brief.
Yeah. I was on the radio on election night with Justin Kaufman over on Extension 720, and I was remarking to Bruce just before we went on that it's really weird. All of these political types all sitting there doing live radio and not really understanding until the next morning that she walked off with practically every precinct of every ward. I mean, it's something that it's just almost unimaginable in Chicago.
But turnout was
but
only
turnout.
31%.
Yes. But turnout, yes.
Turnout was very depressing. It continues to be depressing.
Yeah.
So again, she won this great victory, but again, there's a lot of people out there in the city of Chicago that didn't take the time to go and vote for her or vote at all. Right. So
the Board of Elections will tell you that, you know, we're better than New York, we're better than LA, we're better than a lot of these smaller municipalities, but you know, back in the Harold Washington days, we had 82% turnout.
Exactly. Yeah, but it was a completely different time.
Yeah.
I mean, I just totally reject any connection, any comparisons between Harold Washington and what happened on Tuesday. I just don't think there's any connection.
Well, there's no connection in that. I mean, first of all, she's a different candidate completely.
Right. Right.
And secondly, when you look at the communities, the communities are gutted.
Mm-hmm.
And so the people aren't there. There's not the synergy. There's not the energy. Yeah. It's not the same excitement, no matter what. I mean, I was in those communities. I had automatic races in those communities.
Yeah.
There was no excitement like there was when Harold Washington ran.
But there's not even the excitement that there was in 15 when we had 41% turnout for the runoff between Chewy and Romp.
Mm-hmm.
I think the big issue here is, to a lot of Chicagoans, this was two black women running for an office.
Mm-hmm.
So does that really excite the white community? Mm. Does it really excite the Hispanic community?
Yes, 47 and 41 and 19 all turned out. Those were all white people.
But those were police and fire. Those were city people that had a vested interest in who won. The rest of the community, I don't think, was necessarily, it wouldn't have been, the turnout is based on black versus white.
Well, I would say the turnout is based on if there's a perception that the two candidates are really different and you have to pick a side, right? I mean, that's the Harold Washington thing, when you're up against Epton or something like that. And also, as you point out, Chewy and Rahm, there was a choice there. There was, you could be on one side or the other. It was hard to be on one side or the other with Lightfoot versus Preckwinkle. It just didn't feel like there was battle.
And the other thing in the black community, I mean, the bottom line is, it's a wait and see, because many black residents don't believe that their lives are going to change no matter who's in office.
What.
And that's what they've seen repeatedly.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so when they gave Rahm Emanuel 55% of the vote the first time and then gave him 55% of the vote the second time after he clearly had abused you, but it was, well, you know, maybe he'll be different, and especially when Barack Obama said, oh no, he was just hard-headed. Give him a second chance.
Yeah.
Okay, well, let's give him a second chance. After two chances, and nothing changes, it's like, okay, you know, whoever wins, we'll see. It's a wait-and-see attitude.
It's also a lot of, part of a generational, I don't mean millennials because they didn't vote, I'm just saying, but I think there was a generational debate going on in the African-American community. I mean, all the establishment African-American leaders, whether it's Congressman Rush or Bobby Davis, Danny Davis, or Jesse White, I mean, they were all in one direction, and, you know, Lori was there with some more of the activist community to some extent, although a lot of the activist community were for Tony Preckwinkle. I mean, one of the big losers was Chance the Rapper.
Yeah.
I mean, he lost twice.
Well, the only good thing about that is that he was in it. And given that millennials weren't in it, I had a millennial candidate in the 20th Ward who, at the very beginning of the campaign, when I told her, I said, millennials don't vote, I mean, her eyes got big, like, oh no, you're wrong. And I'm like, yeah, right. Okay, we'll see. And so the only thing I can say for Chance is that at least he got in it and said, I'm going to get involved and tried to lead by example. Even if you didn't follow his example, he was trying to lead by example to say, you must come out to vote.
You were working.
But it still didn't work.
No, it didn't
even
work.
Even with a celebrity person like Chance,
it didn't work.
And someone that's given a lot to the community, it didn't, you can't transfer those endorsements, just like obviously the endorsement of Jesse White didn't help Tony Preckwinkle very much.
Insulting, AD, to turn to you at this time?
I mean, any coalition building, it takes time. It's not a switch that flips where you see Chance the Rapper on TV and say, I'm going to go vote.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
And we also saw a lot of millennials organizing for these younger candidates that have swept in city council. So I think there's a lot to be said for that. I know a lot of DSA-aligned millennials who are so excited about these five new city council members that they helped elect. So if they didn't turn out, at least they were organizing.
Yeah, and that really, that's the first stage, right? The organizing is more important than the turnout if you're trying to build for something.
Yeah, especially if you're building for 2020.
Yeah, yeah, there's that too, yeah. So did Lori Lightfoot get a mandate She seems to be thinking that she has a mandate because she got, because she won every precinct. Is it a mandate?
Well, yes.
Well, the mandate is that people want change. I mean, that's the real mandate. That was the message that was sent. I mean, that was the message sent in February when they rejected Bill Daley. So it was it was saying, you know, your time has passed and it's time for a new day. And so then we saw that for Tony, she represented the old, and Lori represented the new.
I suppose that really is true. And people who like the old way, they had more than enough opportunities to vote for the old way, and they didn't. In the first election, so maybe that is the mandate. Is it's time to move on? You know,
and move on to what?
Well,
we don't know.
It's aspirational.
That's right.
And that's what it was. It was all aspirational. But the most important part of this is that if you actually do want to see change, and you do want to see reform, and you do want to see a new kind of city government in terms of being responsive to you, then you're going to have to hold Lori's feet to the fire. I mean, it doesn't stop at the fact that you voted for her. It now is she must deliver on all the things that she talked about.
They want something new and fresh. And clearly Lori was new and fresh. She was the person that nobody sent. And she made it all the way. All the pundits were wrong. Everybody was wrong about Lori. On the other side, you knew what you were going to get. You were not going to get any change with Tony Preckwinkle. You weren't going to get any great vision with her.
Okay. Well, then, all right. So we seem to be agreed that there is a call for radical change. But now the question is, how do you do radical change when the first thing you have to do is clean up all the giant mess that's in the room, right? I mean, you can. At this point, she's walking in completely pure, right? She's got her job to do. She's got her bottle of water half drunk, so she knows she's got work to do. And then she just kind of walks into this, you know, billion-dollar pension mess and all the rest of it. And somehow or other, she's got to bring in some unbelievably powerful allies to make some of these things work that her predecessor couldn't do. How does that work?
First of all, I disagree with the premise.
Okay, good.
She is not going to be a person that's going to bring radical change. There was not radical change, at least at the mayor's level, that was running there. In the aldermanic races, yes. But Lori is a, as Tony would say, she is a corporate lawyer.
Yeah.
She is comfortable walking into a boardroom, and she's comfortable walking into maybe a rally somewhere. Someday even a rally on the south or west side. I don't know whether the comfort level is with her right now to do that. But she doesn't surround herself with radicals. She surrounds herself with reformers, business types that want, you know, a fair day's work for fair day's pay and stuff like that. But I don't think we're going to get radical change. We're going to get change, though.
Well, what's going to and I agree with you. What's going to change is the fact that you're going to have a different makeup in the city council, and that's where the change is going to be. But I think also that's where they're going to push her, and so we're going to see some of that we haven't seen before. Because what we've seen before is rubber stamp and marching lockstep, and I don't think you're going to see the same kind of rubber stamp and marching lockstep that we've seen.
Well, so then that brings us to that central question about the city council, doesn't it? I mean, we're now a couple of days out from the election as we're recording this on Thursday. We might have a pretty good view. I mean, we see that the 5th and the 33rd and the 46th ward are still out. It'll be a week or two before we know for sure who wins those. But what it looks like to me is just a kind of a mess. It's just like there's a little bit of this, a little bit of that.
Yes.
And I don't look at the city council and say, oh, I think we're going to see this happen or that happen.
No, I think we see a conservative Northwest Side block. We see a few...
The White Caucus.
A few establishment folks still hanging out. We still have Ed Burke. We still have Marty Quinn. We have these DSA folks who are further to the left than the existing Progressive Caucus. Scott Wagasbeck said in the Tribune that, you know, Carlos Ramirez Rosa, who is the one-man DSA caucus today, but will be probably the leader of a 5 or 6-member DSA caucus, has not been that involved in what the Progressive Caucus is doing. And then you've got a group of folks who are kind of a rubber stamp type, not necessarily because they agreed wholeheartedly with Emanuel or with Daley, but because they could get what they needed out of the mayor, and it behooved them to be that rubber stamp because they could get good stuff for their community.
So that's true rubber stampism.
And that's no matter who the mayor was.
Correct.
Right. So they can adapt.
So building coalitions is going to be difficult and interesting.
Yeah.
And I can't even tell you who the floor leader is going to be. I can't tell you who the head of finance is going to be. I can't tell you who the head of zoning is going to be.
Yeah.
The publicity and all the news has been about the Democratic Socialists who won. And there was, you know, five, maybe six of them. The reality is there are five or six votes in a body of 50 people. So as has been stated here, although they're getting all the publicity, because just like AOC is getting all the publicity in Congress, she's the new shiny penny. The reality is it's still a minority within the city council. And I think the big issue that she has to tackle is the thorniest one for everybody in that council. She wants to say to each of these 50 aldermen, I want to give you less power. I want to take some of your privilege away from you. That's part of the reform that I think a lot of people voted for. Is this city council going to give that to her? That's going to be the real big battle, because if she can pull that off, really, reform will have come to Chicago.
Well, that's it's so hard to legislate. We've talked about it every time I've been here, that aldermanic prerogative is not a written down code.
Right. It's not a law.
So it's tough to tackle.
Right.
And you'll
have
a lot of aldermen who've been around for a long time that'll definitely push back and say, this is the best way to represent my own community. Stay out of it.
And they endorsed it, and some of those endorsed her as well.
Yeah.
She had a lot of those people
that
would say, you know, you walk into Brendan Riley saying, well, let's get rid of, you know, aldermanic privilege. I mean, he's going to say, well, let me talk to you about this.
Let me think about that for a minute. Especially in the black
community when it takes forever to get anything done in the first place. I mean, when you look at, for instance, the Fifth Ward, when you look at the Fifth Ward, and one of the issues for Leslie Harrison was the grocery store.
Yeah.
It took 6 years to get a grocery store.
Yeah.
That's because, one, she didn't vote with the mayor. And so she didn't get a grocery store. Had she voted with the mayor, she would have gotten a grocery store a lot sooner.
Whole Foods, maybe.
Exactly, in the middle of nowhere. Because that's what happens. Yeah. You know, magic happens.
Yeah.
And so part of it is knowing that everything takes decades to happen on the south side versus you see whole cities being redeveloped on the north side within a city. Aldermanic prerogative has a different meaning on the south side than it has on the north side.
Well, I would say it has a different meaning in every ward.
We don't have Lincoln Yards.
Yeah, yeah.
We don't have Project 78. You know, you're trying to get a grocery store, and it takes you 6 years, and you've got density.
So this
is not a ward that's one of the wards that's been gutted out.
Yeah.
This is a ward that has density.
Yeah. I find that really fascinating, and actually, I have to tell you that I think I just kind of, I'm like really torn on this whole aldermanic prerogative thing. It just sounds so, it sounds so clear cut when you talk about the 5150 project and you know, up on the northwest side and how a couple of aldermen were able to just completely shut down any possibility of affordable housing being brought into all white wards on the northwest side. That's where it's wrong. But on the other hand, there are other examples of where an alderman can actually make something happen because he or she has that prerogative to make it happen, that it's not a binary debate
I'll go back to the Fifth Ward again as another example, and only because I know this ward as I've been working with Leslie for years. But let's take the Starbucks, when she brought Starbucks, and that's a prime example. When she first came to the city and asked about a Starbucks on the south side, she was told to lower her expectations. No, you don't really want a Starbucks. Why don't you look at a dollar store? Why don't you look at something? And she said, no, I really want a Starbucks. And so that's why I'm telling you that it was a relationship with someone who knew Magic Johnson, who then he went to Starbucks, and that's how she got it. So it's a very different story. You can't do broad strokes on the south side and the north side and compare them because they're not the same.
Yeah. Is this the 53rd Street?
The one on 71st and Stony Island.
Yeah, okay.
And of course, when Starbucks did the traffic study, it was a no-brainer.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, look, there's people here.
Right.
And they drink coffee.
Now their biggest regret is it's not a bigger Starbucks because it's one of the most profitable.
Yeah. Well, I want to... promised myself that I would ask you guys about unions because, well, schools in particular. I mean, CTU doesn't look to me like they came out very well in the tallies
mixed bag.
On this.
Yeah. Huh? Mixed bag.
Mixed bag. Yeah. I mean, but you know, they chose their horse early, and then they probably regretted they did that. But I'm fascinated by the Illinois Network of Charter Schools. I mean, they put a lot of money into some races, and they're claiming 6 out of 8 right now because they got Lopez, Coleman, Brookins, Reboiras, of course, and Cardona and Nugent. But they've got at least these 8 pretty solid pro-charter votes.
And a few in the first round, I think.
And there are,
overall, 10 out of 13.
Yeah, okay.
But there were also a lot of campaigns that rejected their money, mm-hmm. didn't want their money because of what it would mean, how it would taint
them. What it looks like, yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
And so, you know, you've got those who will take any money, right. no matter who gives it to them. And then there were people who said no.
Yeah. But, I mean, I just have to think that if you're a, I don't know, plumber or something, and your union is putting money into one of these campaigns, you're looking at this today and you're saying, why is my union even wasting money on a campaign like this? What's it going to do for me? How is my bricklayer's union going to benefit from one of these ladies?
Well, you're hoping that it will in terms of the public policy that comes along with it, or the development, or whatever. So, mm-hmm. I mean, when you look at, we have more cranes dotting the skyline than at any time or mm-hmm. anywhere else. And then you, at the same time, around the holidays, you had the service workers picketing the hotels.
Yeah.
And so this is one union, and mm-hmm. they're making money hand over fist. Mm-hmm. This is another union that's begging for health care and benefits.
Right,
and
right.
so that's why you do it.
Yeah.
Insofar as getting back to the automatic prerogative, I think a city that wants to continue to be in the forefront of visionary activity, I think you have to look at the totality of the city, not just what's happening in one ward over the other. And mm-hmm. I think that's one thing that Lori has said, at least during the campaign, mm-hmm. one reason why she wants to get rid of it.
Mm-hmm. I noticed that Bill Daley's idea of cutting the council to 15 members, that kind of went away with him, didn't it?
Yeah, it did.
I remember thinking at the time when he was sitting here and we were talking, and I was thinking, if you don't make it to the mayor's office, I don't think this idea is going to stick around very long.
I remember talking to Patrick Daley Thompson, who I think is his nephew.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was like, I'm obviously not crazy about that idea.
And,
good luck
and
elsewhere.
I sort of disagree with what you said, because part of why the South Side and the West Side look like they do is because we're not looking at it ward by ward. We're looking at it as downtown centric, and that's how we're making all these decisions. Yeah. And so there isn't the same kind of whole picture. Let's mm-hmm. see what we can do over here. Let's see what we can do over there. Because there are other things that could be developed in the South Side. I mean, you've got these swaths mm-hmm. of vacant land where, I mean, it was almost, when I was going through Inglewood, I mean, tears came to mm-hmm. my eyes while I was driving through there. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, when you think about, these were houses, these were families, these were children outside playing. Mm-hmm. I know the kind of neighborhood I grew up in. Mm-hmm. And you don't see any of that. And for instance, in the 20th Ward, now you have Norfolk Southern that has expanded. Just, I mean, and it's
wiped
just
out an entire,
and it's in 3 or 4 wards, it's mm-hmm. so big. Mm-hmm. But, and yet there's not a local, where have you ever seen any kind of industrial anything the size of Norfolk Southern, mm-hmm. and not a local watering hole anywhere, yeah. not a local restaurant. Yeah. Where do those people go? Is everything so self-contained?
No, I'm not Lori.
No, we're fine.
You need to make up the same height.
That's okay.
Delmarie Cobb.
Go ahead, Rich.
The point I'm saying is that all the frustration that you have, I think, is part of the frustration that a lot of voters have had, black and white, who look at these huge areas that have not been developed. I'm just saying is that if this city and Lori Lightfoot can bring in a more visionary team mm-hmm. of planners, mm-hmm. they will see where the pockets of opportunity are. And they are on the South and West Sides. Some of the greatest housing stock is on the South and West Side, the parks, the boulevards. I mean, I drive through those areas, I'm saying, just the opportunities here are phenomenal. So it's, the opportunity is there if you bring in the right people. The city has not brought in the right people. They have been north side centric.
And they have to not only bring in the right people, but you do have to work with the aldermen in a less paternalistic way. Mm-hmm. It cannot be, I'm telling you what's best for you. I need you to tell me what's best for your community. And so, that's the difference.
So if Lori called me for my recommendation and I and I said that I'd like to have you made planning commissioner, can you answer a couple of very elementary questions for me? Is it possible in the commercial realm to be a commercial developer who develops in Chicago large swaths of really quality, low-income housing? Can it be done without, well, I mean, it isn't being done by anybody at this point, but can it be done in the private sector? I mean, does all the development have to be along Milwaukee Avenue and, you know, half a block from the Blue Line?
No, not at all. And it doesn't have to be large developments. I mean, I would start with infill housing.
That's what I'm asking.
Yeah, if I was going to do development in the communities that are wanting, I would do infill housing.
Yep.
And I would bring in, I mean, some, for instance, again, you've got Michael Reese site. Mm-hmm. We're paying $95 million for this site to sit empty. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is a prime example of what I was saying in terms of lack of vision. What, you know, it's location.
Lack of vision, that was going to be the
Olympic site.
Athletes. Right, and that's why I fought against it, because I'm ground zero. But you know, location. Yeah. What better location could you want? You're next to all the expressways, you're next to the convention center, you're next to the lakefront, and yet it's sitting there dormant.
Yeah.
And so that's what I'm saying, is that you don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure this out. You can build things just like you're building Lincoln Yards. Mm-hmm. I mean, we don't necessarily want a Lincoln Yards, but you certainly can talk to the community and say, let's build some housing like Prairie Shores or Lake Meadows. I mean, when you look at what that was, and immediately it was filled, it serves a purpose, and it was
50 years ago.
Right. Yeah. And it was supposed to be, and it was an experiment. Mm-hmm. It was an experiment, model cities, to see, could you take a suburban idea and build it in the city, and would it work?
Yeah.
That was the genesis.
And it was a success that hasn't been replicated.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, when you speak to affordable housing folks, they're not the ones calling for rent control. They're calling for preservation of the existing amazing affordable housing stock on the south and west sides, which takes some city vision. Mm-hmm. But there's a lot more that can be done on a smaller scale. Mm-hmm. We don't need these gigantic developments necessarily. Mm-hmm. We need to preserve what's there and then also work to, you know,
and add to it.
Yeah, add
to
it.
I mean, even the Norfolk Southern, here's a prime example. It should have been one-for-one replacement housing.
Absolutely.
That's what should have happened there.
Right, you want to knock all these houses down to expand your rail yard?
Well,
what do you, right.
Exactly, and the idea that you didn't even ask for that?
Yeah.
I mean, that is just unbelievable to me.
Yeah. I think the key word of this whole discussion here today is infill. I mean, it's one thing to be, as you say, I mean, even Prairie Shore was a urban renewal project, right? A lot of people lost their homes for that to happen. We don't need to be pushing people out of their homes to do this. They've already left. 300,000 people have already left. What are we doing with this incredible asset? I'm very frustrated by it, and I just can't understand why we just don't seem to have the vision to be able to rebuild a community.
And what's good about it is that everything is in place. It's not like the suburbs where you're having to put in infrastructure.
The street grid
is there. And what we're spending, what I often say, is that it costs as much to remove snow on a street that has one house as it does on a street that's full of houses.
So
this is crazy. It's unsustainable.
I'll be fascinated to see if there's a sustained band of development from the South Loop all the way down to the Obama Presidential Center.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if the city can approach it in a way that doesn't mean displacement from
folks
that already live
there.
Exactly.
The answer, I think, simply is, there will be, as long as the right developers get the right parcels. But how do you deal with the displacement issue? Mm-hmm. And we've seen far too much displacement in the last 50 years. It's kind of crazy. Should we talk about schools for a few minutes?
Sure.
Chalkbeat is out with a really big piece today. I actually printed it out because I'm an old man and sometimes I like to print things. It's a really long piece about the different issues that Lori Lightfoot is going to be facing. And I think, you know, the school closing thing is a really big thing, but the really big issue is this thing about the school board and what happens, because it all goes back to the school board and what policies the school board sets. I will say again, I've never been completely convinced that this elected school board 100% is the right answer. It frightens me. But
it worries,
silence.
It worries me too. I think it further politicizes. There's politics there. It just further politicizes it. And I'm not a big fan of it, but I'm not horribly against it either. But I don't like the idea of politicizing a school board, I think it would happen.
Well, I guess all school boards are politicized.
Yes, I know.
By their very nature, they are. But, you know, we were talking earlier about all the unions dumping money into the...
And the charter schools.
And the charter schools dumping money into the city council because they want their aldermen to be on board. Imagine what it would be like if they were electing a school board member.
Yes.
And even though, I mean, I support it, but I do it with a caveat because I support it because it has worked in every place else. In Illinois, and we're the only school system that doesn't have it.
But ours is so big.
I know, exactly. And that's why I said there's a caveat. And then the other part is that we don't vote for what we should be voting for. What would make me think that we're gonna vote for a school board? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, how do you address that whole issue of people not being engaged
and
then money coming
councils.
In?
Yeah.
Exactly,
yes.
And then money coming in to put people on there they want.
Yeah.
But what we do know is that the current system isn't working.
I was gonna say, just in case, dear viewer, you're thinking that the four of us are saying we really like the system as it is, I don't think so. No, I don't think that's what
But it
is.
It comes back to the people, and now there's a new leader.
Yeah.
The new leader has a new vision.
Right.
She's got a different background.
Mm-hmm.
She will bring a sensitivity to the new job that is before her that will make the idea of a school board appointed by her mm-hmm. is going to be different than a school board appointed by a predecessor or by Tony Preckwinkle.
And I think under the current proposal, the school board elections wouldn't begin until 2023, so regardless, we would have several years of a Lightfoot appointed school
board. So she might just be able to say to all the critics, you know what, let me have this one. Let me do this appointment thing here for a couple of years.
She'll have to,
I think I got some ideas about how we can do this with appointments. I don't know.
Well, there's already the plotting to replace her has already begun. So,
I'm sure that's true.
She's got 46 days to get there, and then it starts over.
And then the next election begins.
Because I think whether it's Jesus Garcia or whether it's Susana Mendoza or anyone else within the Latino community, I think they want to know when is our turn, and that's going to continue to grow. The coalition of African Americans and Latinos has never been, successful in any significant way in Chicago.
They're at each other's
throats.
The closest it was to being successful was under Harold Washington.
Yes, right.
And of course, it was not in Daley's interest to make it successful.
Absolutely.
That's what the HDO was all about. And a lot of what we're seeing, the remnants of HDO is what we're seeing. The jobs lost.
Yeah.
And people in the black community feeling that the reason they didn't support Jesus is because they felt that there is no coalition between black and brown coalition.
Mm-hmm.
And so why are we gonna support somebody, to lose more jobs, the few jobs that we have? And so this was all done on purpose.
But I mean, if Jesus Garcia, he went to Washington with the understanding that he would be there for one or two terms and then come roaring back. Is that still the plan? I think that was the plan when Rahm Emanuel was still there. I think that was the deal that was done involving Luis Gutierrez. Mm. But that deal is over. Louis couldn't even elect his own daughter.
Mm-hmm.
So, who is the leader of the Latino? Is it Chuy Garcia, he's in Washington. Someone's going to emerge out of this city council to be someone.
Yeah.
Is it going to be Susana Mendoza? Well, she's the state controller for another 4 years.
I don't think it's going to be Susana, and I think it's going to be Chuy to some degree, and I think Gilbert
Villegas
is the other person who's trying to step up.
We've also got to see how the rest of these indictments play out.
Yeah,
there will be more.
There is that. That's right. That we haven't even talked about that.
There will be more.
You know, this morning, it was recorded yesterday, but Lori Lightfoot made like national news this morning on NPR. I don't know if you know this, but she spoke about David March and Thomas Gaffney and Joseph Walsh, the three officers who were acquitted in the Laquan McDonald thing. And
about the code of silence.
Yeah, about the code of silence. And I just realized that I lost the quote. Isn't that awful? Isn't that terrible? But anyway, essentially what she said was that she was going to ask for it to be reevaluated, to looked into again, because she thought that it was an unfair judgment. And so I'm sure that plays very well with one half of her mandate constituency, but with the other half, it's not so popular at all. Was that a wise thing to do, to tell NPR that yesterday?
Well, I mean, I guess she figures if I'm going to say it, do it while I'm on the honeymoon.
Yeah,
that can, you know, this
do
is
it
my
on NPR.
Yeah, this is the only time I have to do it.
Yeah.
Because she certainly, once she gets in there, she's not going to be able to do it. And if she does, I mean, there's going to be retaliation in terms of pushback.
So then maybe this was just kind of like a sweet sop to some of the people who were adamant supporters of hers.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it hurts her, certainly, from all the other groups, especially in the black community, when everybody thinks that anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So she actually does need to solidify her relationship with the black community.
Yeah.
It's not like she has a long history with the black community.
Right.
So there is an establishment period that she's going to have to make, because when she goes in there and makes some of these tough decisions, she's going to need a base that supports her and has her back.
I think in doing that with the base, I think speaking out on police issues is going to be dicey for her.
Mm-hmm.
It was dicey for her when she had the positions previously,
because
you know she was viewed by some people as, you know, as anti-police,
mm-hmm.
and in the black community she was perceived as too pro-police.
Yeah.
And she's a former federal prosecutor.
Mm-hmm.
So she looks at things and has been on both sides of discussing this issue.
Yeah.
I think the issue where she and Tony Preckwinkle could also forge a strong relationship is on the issue of criminal justice reform.
Oh, yeah.
If she were to move forward on some of the First Step Act in demanding from the Trump administration that be implemented and funded, I mean, that's something that will play well in all communities. It certainly would play well in the African American community, and I think that's the one that best fits her background, where she's from, the relationship that she had with her brother. I mean, the personal impact of having a brother incarcerated for so many years. I mean, you can see when she talks about that, I mean, she gets a little choked up about it. So her passion is there. I think, frankly, that's the area where she's gonna tackle first.
It's been interesting to watch elected officials call for a second look at charges like this. We saw Kwame Raoul do it as well with Jason Van Dyke's sentencing.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't seen it before. I don't know if either of you have, where they ask for relooks at sentencing. That will be interesting, watching her negotiate this consent decree, negotiate the next FOP contract, which has been expired for a year and a half, close to 2 years. Because there are a ton in the police abolition community who think she's a cop and that she can never do anything to satisfy them. And
do anybody think she's already spoken to Kevin Graham? Do you think they've had a conversation yet?
I don't know.
Well, if they have, we won't know it.
That's for sure. Nobody's going to be putting out a press release about that.
I think of all of her advisors. I mean, you know, Jamal Green has been listed in the papers as one of her advisors. I mean, he is knee deep into the grassroots of the city, and he's going to be blowing in her ear, whispering in her ear, and she's got to listen to that and weigh it against the totality of who supported her, and also in her mind, what's best for the city of Chicago. So she's got, she wanted the job, she's got it, she can't complain about it.
You know, we talk about reorganizing the city council and these other things, but one of the things that I think is very much on her plate, excuse me, is reorganizing the city government and all the commissioners and so forth. We talked about planning. I can't believe that David Reifman is going to be surviving the into Lori Lightfoot. But think about all the other departments. I mean, water, you can go down the line, human services, right. Family services. These are all departments that I imagine she's going to want to really kind of make them rethink how they do things.
New Department of Housing, new Department of Environment. It's going to be fascinating.
And the Department of Environment is new. The old Department of Environment is new again.
She also, when I did an interview with her a couple of months ago, she said that she thought that the universities in Chicago were underused. They had not been properly, their brain power had not been properly tapped by previous administrations. So I think we're going to be looking into academia to bring some of these folks in to deal with reality.
Interesting.
And, I don't think there's going to be many holdovers from the Rahm administration. Mm-hmm. But then if she appoints too many people from the Daley administration, that's not going to play well with some constituency. Right. And again, it's been a long time since there was a Harold Washington administration. And some of those people are like us, either retired or getting ready long gone from the scene.
Yeah.
What's interesting is we're not talking about two of the big ones that are probably going to stay, which is Janet Jackson. She has not expressed any willingness to fire her right away. And Eddie Johnson, superintendent of CPD, who she said it would be it'd be terrible to let him go right before this summer.
Right. Yeah.
Those are two big ones I was watching months ago.
I think also in the back of her mind, though, is, she was part of the process that gave three names to Rahm Emanuel.
Right.
And so she thinks that any one of those three would be a good police superintendent. At least she did, 4 years ago, 3 years ago.
Yeah.
So I think she's
although the department then is a different department than
yes,
it is now.
Absolutely. Mm. But she may have a couple of names already in mind.
And she's going to start a new Office of Violence Prevention as well, or Office of Public Safety, I think it was.
And Eddie Johnson is changing some of what he said, too. I mean, one of the reasons why Toni Preckwinkle said she would get rid of him is because he said in 27 years that he was in the police department, he never saw any misconduct in front of him.
Yeah.
And, you figured when he said it, I was just blown away at the time he said it.
Yeah.
And now he's saying, there is a code of silence and we have to address it.
Eddie Johnson did not get to where he is living an entire life in the bureaucracy of the Chicago Police Department without being adaptable. and he's adapted.
Right.
One thing we have not discussed because it's about future politics, but again, I think it's going to be the next big story that all the political junkies are going to be salivating over, and that's Kim Fox. The future of Kim Fox, how many people are going to challenge her for state's attorney?
Mm-hmm.
I predict there will be some. Mm-hmm. I predict there will be many.
But there may be, but she also has time to address this. And, my position on this whole thing with Rahm Emanuel is 16 counts versus 16 shots. And where was your outrage? Now you're outraged. The definition of disingenuous is Rahm Emanuel's outrage.
Mm-hmm.
When you said something you were excited for, I thought you were going to say the remap. I'm so excited for the remap. I'm thinking way ahead.
Well, that will be exciting too, but not like the Kim Fox because of the personal personal aspect of it, the emotion of it involved.
But it's very interesting though to see how the argument that Delmarie makes is beginning to really take root now. It's sort of like this kind of like holding the mirror back up to it and saying, oh yeah, well, where was your outrage
exactly. And just his words. I mean, I was going to do a column on just using his words, disingenuous, and then I was going to go up and down what that means. Abomination? Mm-hmm. This was an abomination?
A whitewash.
Oh my God, come on.
But he's not going to be around in 2 years.
Right.
Nobody's going to be talking about him.
No, and that's why.
I think your point is well taken, but I'm saying as a Rahm Emanuel said never let
a crisis go to waste.
Well, and he this is his example. He wants to. I mean, here's a guy
this guy
is being praised on Fox News now. So he's going out.
But to what end? What is he getting out of this?
He's auditioning for his TV job.
Sure, which he was going to get anyway. We've seen him publish 8 times in the Atlantic in the past since he announced he wasn't running. He's on cable news every weekend. I don't understand what the point of getting so outraged about this was, other than defending all the work that the Chicago Police Department had done investigating it.
And that's what it was. And that's what it was about. The whole idea was that it was a black eye on the city of Chicago. Yeah. It had nothing to do with actually the people involved. Yeah. It was all about, I'm doing all of this to make the city of Chicago look wonderful, and then look at what you do. Now, the fact that people are getting killed on a regular basis, that's okay. And that tourists are afraid to come here, even though we have record tourism, there's still people who say they're afraid to come here. But that's okay. But yeah. Jesse Smollett, oh my God.
Yeah, but a lot of people were outraged. I think a lot of African Americans and whites and everybody else. A lot of people were legitimately outraged. About that decision.
Well, first of all, you're outraged about that decision, but the Aaron Schrock, I mean, that's similar. I mean, it disappeared too, and it was federal, and all of a sudden it went poof up in smoke. So I'm no more outraged about that than I am Jesse Smollett. Mm-hmm. And the bottom line, as far as Jesse is concerned, is, I mean, it never rang true from the beginning. I mean, nobody says this is MAGA country in
Chicago.
MAGA country in Chicago. This is not, you know, some of
not
our
MAGA
neighbors.
Country.
No, and who would know that he was gay at 2 a.m. Right. And I don't even know him. I don't look at Empire. I don't even know him. He could have walked down the street past me. I wouldn't have known who he was. But you've got some white people walking down the street, and they know who he is.
Yeah.
Come on.
Doesn't make any sense.
One of the things that's going to be the most difficult to say for us all to stomach, I think, is going to be watching all of the cable news shows with Rahm Emanuel talking about how he fixed Chicago. In just 8 years, he turned Chicago around. Okay. And it'll be in the first sentence, the word cranes will be in the first
Thanks
sentence.
Thanks for that image.
Yeah.
Record corporate relocations, too.
Record
yes,
corporate
exactly.
relocations.
In case you forgot. And record tourism.
Yeah. And direct foreign investment. I got the full list.
Exactly.
He's got the 5 T's.
And others will be talking about Laquan McDonald.
Yes, that's right. Well, you know, someday we should reconvene this panel to do a post-mortem on the Rahm Emanuel years, because I think it's a really mixed thing. I mean, there have been some good things, but, yeah.
He's gone.
We don't have to do
46 more days.
We don't have to do
He'll
that.
He'll be around. There won't be a tag day for him.
Okay. Yeah. I think he's going to keep living in Chicago?
Yes.
You do?
For a while.
I figured he'd be out of here real quickly. But anyway. He may keep the house. He'll rent it.
In case he wants to come back.
Exactly.
Oh, we love to beat up on old Rahm Emanuel. We've run out of time. And I guess that's probably just a good thing because, you know, you guys have all got to get back to work. So, yeah, do that. Thank you very much. Thanks for being here today. Thanks to Delmarie Cobb with Publicity Works and your candidate. I forgot already. Your candidate was 20. Nicole Johnson, right? Yes. Okay. Yeah. Well, that one's still up in the air, right?
No. It's
no.
Leslie
no.
Harrison.
No. It's not. No.
Yeah.
No.
Fifth ward is up in the air.
Now I start falling apart. Bruce DuMont. The Beyond the Beltway show and sort of the dean of political commentators in Chicago,
yeah.
I would say.
And also, I did something last week on the show that I've never done in all my years.
On your own show?
On Beyond the Beltway.
Oh, you did? You endorsed a candidate?
I endorsed Lori Lightfoot.
First time I'd ever heard you do that.
Right.
Yeah.
Never done it.
So you're a Lori guy. Yes, you are.
Well, I was outraged that Tony Preckwinkle did not take the opportunity to denounce the horrible conduct of Bobby Rush. And the robotic way that she did it infuriated me.
And A.D. Quig from the Daily Line, which
no
is
no endorsements
a,
made.
Which is no, which is a great daily summary of the news, and you should look into it. I'm Ken Davis. We'll be back next week. I have no idea what we're going to talk about next week because we've just been too busy doing this, but we'll find something. So you watch us. Here's the way you go to get to all the past shows and to get to our archives and so forth. And we'll see you next week. Thanks. Bye-bye.